reasons a woman shoots a man. She either loves him or hates him.
Or both.
And that's the sample Catherine pulled off of the secretary's blouse and the hotel man's clothes. Same source. Secretary moved the body.
We just interviewed her. She copped to moving him. We're looking hard at the wife and the poisoning.
The secretary has dandruff.
We know. Dermatomycosis seborrhea. We got it.
Topical eczemas like that require prescription medication. The primary ingredient of those...
...called on to save the ship as the Apple II was losing precious market share.
In the case of the Macintosh team, they were behind schedule in getting the Mac out, which is not unusual in high technology. And so just getting that product to market was extremely important.
After many delays, a date for the launch of the Mac was announced. The pressure of the deadline was mounting, but Steve was still a perfectionist.
No design issue was too small, and it was never too late to do it right.
Oh, it was a pressure cooker. We were working until we finished. We couldn't go to sleep or anything. I was up for 3 days before in that very last push. And finally, just the stars aligned, and the last release we made at 6 a.m. that morning.
It was now all or nothing because Lisa had turned out an expensive flop. The fate of the whole company seemed to rest on the launch of the Mac. John Sculley had even authorized a $15 million advertising campaign to coincide with the Mac's public unveiling, January 24th, 1984.
I remember how nervous Steve was before the introduction of the Macintosh. And the rehearsal the night before was a total disaster. Nothing seemed to go right. Steve was upset at everybody. We wondered how in the world we were ever going to get through the introduction the following day. But when that moment came, Steve was a master showman.
There have only been two milestone products in our industry, the Apple II in 1977 and the IBM PC in 1981. Today, 1 year after Lisa, we are introducing the third industry milestone product, Macintosh. Many of us have been working on Macintosh for over 2 years now, and it has turned out insanely great. You've just seen some pictures of Macintosh. Now I'd like to show you Macintosh in person.
Macintosh was undoubtedly the first affordable personal computer with a genuine graphical user interface. It was also the first computer to be a monument to one man's ego. Forget the brilliant work done at Xerox PARC and the innovations borrowed from the Lisa. On the day, only one man was claiming paternity for the Mac.
So it is with considerable pride that I introduce a man who's been like a father to me, Steve Jobs.
I was standing off stage, and as he came off, he said, "This is, you know, the proudest, happiest moment of my life," and it was all over his face. It clearly was, because he had launched a revolution.
Ultimately, it comes down to taste. It comes down to trying to expose yourself to the best things that humans have done, and then try to bring those things in to what you're doing. I mean, Picasso had a saying, he said, good artists copy, great artists steal. And we have, you know, always been shameless about stealing great ideas. And I think part of what made the Macintosh great was that the people working on it were musicians and poets and artists and zoologists and historians who also happen to be the best computer scientists in the world.
With delusions of grandeur running rampant, Apple created a Hollywood-style TV commercial. It symbolized how the friendly Mac would free us from the Orwellian tyranny of clunky IBM PCs. Please.
One will, one resolve, one cause.
Despite the hype, by late 1984, the Mac's sales were disastrous.
We shall prevail.
This is a highly sophisticated office computer.
In ad after ad, Apple desperately pointed out that the Mac was far easier to use than the IBM PC. But it sold for $2,500, $1,000 more than the IBM. And despite Jobs' best efforts in recruiting software makers like Bill Gates, applications were scarce.
It didn't do very much. We had Mac Paint and Mac Write were our only applications. And the market started to figure this out. By the end of the year, people said, well, maybe the IBM PC isn't as easy to use or is not as attractive as the Macintosh, but it actually does something which we want to be able to do, spreadsheets, word processing, and database. And so we started to see the sales of the Mac tail off towards the end of 1984, and that became a problem the following year.
Cringely's third law of personal computing was right again. To succeed, a PC must have an application which alone justifies buying the whole box. The IBM PC had Lotus 1-2-3. The Mac needed its killer application.
WYSIWYG, another bunch of initials from the world of the nerds. What you see is what you get. So what's the big deal? Well, it turns out that it's very hard to print on paper exactly the same image that you see on the computer screen. 80% of our brain is devoted to processing visual data, but that's not the same for computers. I've been here writing a letter to my mom, and I'm signing it Bob in 72-point Times Roman italic type, as befitting myself. And then when I tell it to print, what comes out is a Bob, but certainly not the Bob that I'd intended. Until someone invented a way to print exactly what was on the screen, GUI would be, well, a lot of hooey.
Apple's problem was the dot matrix printer. It gave everything a typewriter quality. But salvation was at hand, and once again, it owed a lot to Xerox PARC. One of PARC's former brains, John Warnock, had invented a technology that allowed a laser printer to print exactly, precisely what was on your screen. He started a company called Adobe to market his invention.
And what we had figured out how to do that no one else had figured out how to do is drive laser printers.
Within 2 or 3 weeks, we had canceled our internal project. A bunch of people wanted to kill me over this, but we did it. And I had cut a deal with Adobe to use their software, and we bought 19.9% of Adobe at Apple.
The investment paid off. The power of precise laser-printed images and a user-friendly GUI gave birth to a brand new business, desktop publishing. The spreadsheet had made us all accountants. Now, using breakthrough software, we could create fancy artwork, snappy-looking notepaper, even counterfeit money. The Mac had found its killer application and would soon become the PC of choice for any creative business.
It changed my life. Just that one instant when I picked up the mouse, my whole life changed to building a career as a computer artist.
The success of desktop publishing came too late for Apple's founder. In 1985, Mac sales were still flat, but Jobs refused to believe the numbers. He simply behaved as if the Mac was a hot seller from the start.
The grandiose plans of what Macintosh were going to be was just so far out of whack with the truth of what the product was doing. And the truth of what the product was doing was not horrible. It was salvageable. But the gap between the two was just so unthinkable that somebody had to do something, and that somebody was John Sculley.
John Scully, whom Jobs saw as his own creation, presented the board with his strategy to save the company. The plan did not include Steve Jobs.
The board had to make a choice, and I said, look, it's Steve's company. I was brought in here to help, you know. If you want him to run it, that's fine with me. But, you know, we've got to at least decide what we're going to do, and everyone's got to get behind it.
But he took it as a personal attack, started attacking Scully, in which created, you know, backed himself into a corner because he was sure that the board would support him and not Scully.
And ultimately, after the board talked with Steve and talked with me, the decision was that we would go forward with my plans, and Steve left.
What can I say? I hired the wrong guy.
That was Scully?
Yeah. And he destroyed everything I'd spent 10 years working for. Starting with me, but that wasn't the saddest part. I would have gladly left Apple if Apple would have turned out like I'd wanted it to.
People in the company had very mixed feelings about it. Everyone had been terrorized by Steve Jobs at some point or another, and so there was a certain relief that the terrorist would be gone. And on the other hand, I think there was incredible respect for Steve Jobs by the very same people. And we were all very worried what would happen to this company without the visionary, without the founder, without the charisma.
Apple never recovered from losing Steve. Steve was the heart and soul and driving force. Would be quite a different place today. They lost their soul.
The years after Steve Jobs left were the most profitable for Apple Computer.
Apple people worked hard, they played hard. They made the computer business look like a beach party. And with a median age of 27, the company was very sexy too. Maybe too sexy. There was so much sleeping around that they came up with a travel policy back then that men would share rooms with other men on the road and women with other women just to settle it down a bit. They applied the California lifestyle to the computer industry, and the computer industry would never be the same again.
Leading the forces of freedom is Macintosh.
In this bizarre promo to inspire their sales force, Apple stressed that the Mac's ease of use could liberate the pathetic prisoners of the IBM PC.
We'll fight them in the office and the classroom and the desktop with superior weapons.
With improvements to the hardware and the boom in desktop publishing, Mac production went into overdrive. By 1987, Apple was selling a million a year, IBM numbers.
Let's go get them.
The Mac minted money. Half its $2,000 price was pure profit.
Hello, I am Macintosh.
Apple arrogantly assumed their stuff was so good, consumers would always pay a premium for it. Big mistake. The Mac really ought to have won the battle for the desktop. Okay, it was more expensive than an IBM PC, but if what you wanted was a friendly, easy-to-use system, and surely everyone wanted that, then this was the only game in town. At least that's what the boys at Apple thought. But they weren't reckoning on one man, Bill Gates. Gates saw that the Mac's GUI represented a long-term threat to Microsoft's money machine, to DOS, the clunky operating system that sat inside every IBM PC. So Bill had his boys create a GUI that sat on top of DOS, rather like building a fancy facade on an old building. They called it Windows, and it wasn't much at first, but it was good enough to defend the DOS franchise.
February or March of 1984, which was just right after the Apple Macintosh had been introduced. And at that point in time, we were firmly convinced that we needed to bet on graphic user interface, first with the Macintosh and then with Windows.
At Microsoft, it was a long and often frustrating struggle to find a GUI solution that challenged the Mac. I know the feeling. For years, teams of Microsofties slaved in their windowless offices to build Windows. refreshed by an endless supply of free sodas.
And I was the development manager for Windows 1.0, and you know, we kept slogging and slogging, and yeah, it took us, I don't know, about 7 versions, but it took us a few versions to get things right before 1990, that's right.
Windows may at first have been a joke compared to the Mac, but Gates is persistent. Slowly it got better, and the guys at Apple got worried. As each new feature appeared on the Windows GUI, the more they thought Microsoft was copying the features on the Mac. So finally, they sued Microsoft, accusing them in a long legal battle of stealing the look and feel of Apple's GUI.
The look and feel, which is how it looks, the experience of using it, was not patentable, but it was copyrightable. But there was no precedent law. This was going to be a precedent-setting case.
But it was a period of 5 years where, you know, Microsoft, our whole strategy would have been ruined because Windows was very important to us.
They weren't going to change anything. And they were going to get us to cave in or take us all the way to the Supreme Court on this thing.
We assumed that the lawyers, the judges would all come to the right conclusion, which eventually they did.
And Apple lost. But in that period of about 6 years that this case was going on, it may have lulled us into a bit of complacency, thinking that we were going to be insulated, you know, from the Windows attack.
The launch of Windows 3 in 1990 killed off Apple's hopes that the Macintosh would win the GUI wars.
Today we're introducing Microsoft Windows version 3.
The 6-year labor to produce a GUI that made IBM PCs and all the clones as easy to use as the Mac finally came up trumps. In a year, Windows 3 sold close to 30 million copies, consigning the Mac to a niche in the market.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Windows 3 development team.
Bill Gates' strategy won out. At every stage in the PC's development, he joined the leading hardware company, and by carving out a dominant market share for his product, made his software the industry standard.
You know, the original PC did our evangelism in the way we created tools for that, you know, pull that together. Take Windows, did we bet our company on that? Did that come together? Virtually everything we've done when we first come out with it, there's a lot of skepticism. But most of the things, we really stuck with them. And despite all that second-guessing, we're able to pull them off.
The problem was the industry wasn't measured by who has the best-selling personal computer, you know, or who has the most innovative technology. The industry was measured by who had the most open system that was adopted by the most other companies. And the Microsoft strategy ultimately turned out to be the better business strategy.
The only problem with Microsoft is they just have no taste. They have absolutely no taste, and what that means is, I don't mean that in a small way, I mean that in a big way, in the sense that they don't think of original ideas, and they don't bring much culture into their product. And you say, well, why is that important? Well, you know, proportionally spaced fonts come from typesetting and beautiful books. That's where one gets the idea. If it weren't for the Mac, they would never have that in their products. And so I guess I am saddened, not by Microsoft's success. I have no problem with their success. They've earned their success for the most part. I have a problem with the fact that they just make really third-rate products.
I will admit, quite frankly, that I think Windows today is probably 4 years behind, 3 years behind, where it would have been had we not danced with IBM for so long. Because the amount of split energy, split work, split IQ in the company really cost our end customer real innovation in our product line. And so whenever I hear these criticisms, which I gotta say sting sometimes, I say to myself, just you watch Windows 95, Windows 90. There's no lack of focus. There hasn't been here for the last 3-4 years since we didn't have this big split with IBM. And I think even in the operating systems area, now you'll start to see clear, and people will recognize clear leadership.
And we just keep making them better. We get millions of phone calls. We get to go out there and talk to customers. And there's nothing cast in concrete. If people decide there's something that we should change, we change it. It's a lot better than most industries in that sense. I think the way that applications user interfaces have advanced over the last decade, Microsoft has been at the forefront of a very high percentage of that. And, you know, I think it's great stuff.
On August 24th, 1995, Gates delivered the coup de grace to his software rivals. Windows 95 combines the PC's operating system and its graphical interface into one package. With a worldwide promotional campaign costing $300 million, it looks set to become the industry standard, supplanting Microsoft's old warhorse, DOS.
Thanks all of you for an incredible job.
Cue the triumph of Bill. A software nerd is the richest man in the world. But even as Bill Gates bestrides the PC world like a colossus, ahead lie bigger battles. Battles that will make the trouncing of the Mac and mastering the IBM PC look like a tea party. The Gates fortune was built on setting the industry standard for PC operating systems. Fine as long as PCs are standalone boxes on your desk. But now they are being linked into a worldwide network, the much-hyped information superhighway. The PC on the internet is a mailbox, a telephone, and a television.
Of course, at the center of this will be the idea of digital convergence. That is, taking all the information, books, art, movies, and being able to provide them on demand on what the PC will evolve into.
The internet is the next wave of the information revolution where there is as yet no industry standard, a world where even Bill Gates seems unsure.
You know, if you take the way the internet is changing month by month, if somebody can predict what's going to happen 3 months from now, 9 months from now, even today, my hat's off to them. I think we've got a phenomenon here that is moving so rapidly that nobody knows exactly where it will go.
Bill Gates isn't resting on his laurels. He's making new alliances, like investing in Steven Spielberg's new movie studio, DreamWorks.
It would be silly if we were going to get into the interactive business.
He's in cable TV with broadcaster NBC and in competition with Rupert Murdoch and Mickey Mouse.
Now, as Microsoft,
these tycoons are a far cry from the nerds Bill has so far outsmarted. Guys like Gary Kildall, who became businessmen by accident. Even Bill's victory over IBM was really with a corporate outpost a long way from the attention of Big Blue headquarters. No, Bill's new rivals are hotshots, not hippies. And one of them is the guy I'm visiting. He hopes the internet will go somewhere other than to Bill Gates' bottom line. He's betting it will soon consign the PC itself to the trash can and do the same to Microsoft.
Bob Cringer, this is Larry Ellison.
Larry Ellison is the boss of Oracle, a booming business that sells software to companies who share information among hundreds of users.
This is my favorite fish, it's Halloween fish.
In Atherton, the most exclusive suburb in Silicon Valley, the bachelor billionaire has built himself a $10 million samurai mansion, naturally.
I want to have a large pond, about 5 acres of water, surrounded by several little buildings, like a village.
Oh, and make it with his ceremonial carp, Larry contemplates the coming battle with Microsoft.
People make a terrible mistake of thinking IBM is the present and Microsoft is the future. I think IBM is the past and Microsoft is the present, and the future has not happened, so we don't know what company, what technology is going to be dominant.
These are temple guardians from the Kamakura period. And they, you know, you'd have one on either side of your door, and the job was to scare employees of Microsoft away and keep them from entering the temple.
We shouldn't spend all of our time wringing our hands about, you know, Microsoft, you know, Microsoft world domination. That there's still room left for innovation. There's going to be change, and Microsoft's future is not assured.
That's how, well, anything good for the internet, we're very supportive of it. Because the internet does not require a PC.
Larry believes the PC will be replaced with a cheap device he calls an information appliance. It will be a glorified television which will access information and computing simply by connecting to giant computers via the internet. Just like turning on a tap, and the PC will go the way of the well and the bucket.
I hate the PC with a passion. Me going down to the store and buying Windows 95, gotta get in my car, drive down to a store, buy a cardboard box full of bits, you know, encoded on a piece of plastic, a CD-ROM, bring it home, read a manual, and install this thing. You must be kidding. You know, put the stuff on the net. It's bits. Don't put bits in cardboard. Cardboard in trucks. Trucks to stores. Me go to the store, pick this stuff out. It's insane. Okay, I love the internet. I want information, It flows across the wire.
So the way ahead is wired. Larry, Bill, everybody agrees on that. And we have the nerds of the 70s to thank for making it possible, whether the PC itself survives or not. As we take up their challenge, it's worth finding out how these pioneers made out. Steve Jobs sold all his Apple stock in disgust when he was fired, but has made another fortune from his stake in a movie animation studio. He has no doubts about his contribution to humanity.
And if you talk to people that use the Macintosh, they love it. I mean, you don't hear people loving products very often, really. But you could feel it in there. There was something really wonderful there.
Apple, the company Jobs took from a garage to the Fortune 500, is in trouble. It is now a fading force in the PC marketplace. Apple's other millionaire founder, Steve Wozniak, spends much of his time teaching computing to 11 and 12-year-olds. IBM created the mass market for the PC, but no longer sets industry standards. And most of the guys who built IBM's first PC have left Big Blue. And Ed Roberts, who built the Altair, the very first PC, he turned his back on computing and returned to his first love, medicine. Funny, isn't it, how things turn out? After all, the first PC revolution caught us all pretty much by surprise. Even Microsoft, with 2,000 millionaires and at least 2 billionaires, never expected to be as successful as they are today. Cringley's universal law says society takes 30 years to adapt new technology into daily life. The phone, movies, even television took that long before our rear ends became couch-shaped. So far, the PC has had 20 years. So what comes next? Well, I'm off to find out. See you in 10 years.